Let's see what they're up to. Well, that, everybody, is just astounding. While we sit here with the sleeping lions, well, one clean itself. Who would have thought it? Well, I suppose everybody who loves the nincompoops. They have pulled it out of the bag and killed a buffalo here exactly as we wanted them to. Lion kills at night. How fantastic they have been. This bunch has been doing not a great deal. Since I last saw you, obviously we were stuck. That is not an uncommon occurrence for me. And what happened was... Oh, sorry. We're going straight back to South Africa. There's even more action going on. They've got cubs running into the kill.
Look who's arrived. Hello, little ones. Our cubs are all on their way. And in a way, whilst it doesn't make everything better, what we've just witnessed, it certainly makes us feel a little bit more comfortable about what we've just witnessed as 8 hungry mouths are about to be fed. There they go, off behind us. Dave, I think there's one on the right as well, I mean on the left. Oh, there was. Could just hear it in the darkness. Okay, I think that's everyone. I'm just going to wait until they've gone a little bit further behind me, and then I'm going to turn our vehicle around and we'll catch up with them. Wow, what an intense night this has been. Hoping there's nobody here. Hello. Going to go move very, very slowly. And I'm just going to check behind me. And then Dave's going to provide me with that infrared light. And it'll take us to the cubs. All right, Dave, I'm in your hands now. I'm driving blind. There they go, over the ridge. I'm just going to make very, very sure that there's not one on the other side of us. I can see them up ahead. I'm not going very fast and I'm not racing to catch up with them because I don't want to risk. I can only see a couple of meters in front of me. So we're going really, really slowly. As the cubs make their way to a meal that the females worked incredibly, incredibly hard to get for them. Whoopsie, I think the road's a little bit to the left there. That's so amazing, the silhouettes of the lions in front of me. I don't know if we're going to be able to capture it. But there they all go. Little cubs. Isn't that incredible? With their amazing mothers. Calling, frolicking, playing, chasing each other around. In high spirits, the females just exhausted after that trial that they were put through. And the cubs bounding in anticipation of some very, very full bellies. Pouncing on each other. And although it's very, very hard to watch an animal die like that, remembering that there are hungry little mouths to feed is definitely a comfort. Look at you, you little scamps. Hmm? Are you too gorgeous for words? The poor lionesses, they're so exhausted. And all the little ones want to do is play with them. It just goes to show that lioness that left earlier on in the hunt went straight to fetch the cubs as soon as she knew that that buffalo was going down. And those two lionesses went off to fetch them. Just little silhouettes in green. Amazing. Well done, Nkuhumas. Sorry, Mr. Buffalo. All right, let's jump on board with Brent as they make their way over in his direction.
Here we go, the first of the cubs have arrived at the buffalo kill. Here they come. Now, let's see, the first one, who's going to be the first one to rush towards the carcass? Get ready for some of the fiercest little sounds you've heard in a while. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Ooh, eight. Now, as they get bigger, Auntie Amber is not going to be as tolerant as she once was. Just checking it's not live, Ma. Making sure you did your job. Oh, scuttling about. Happy cubbies. Now they seem so well fed, they're more interested in playing than eating. Perfect, thanks yours. So here we go, as you can see, we are sitting absolutely in the pitch black. I cannot see a thing, and I'm looking at my monitor. What has that cub got at the back there? Is that my hat? No, I'm joking, it's not my hat. It's the tail. Yes, I could have lost my hat, but he's stolen the tail. He's having a great game with it. Isn't this incredible? This infrared enables us to view cubs at night. Normally, no spotlights on cubs until they're about between 6 and 8 months old. But with infrared, we remove. Look at him. Looks very impressed with himself. Come on, cheers, yours. Have a good evening.
It was awesome to
enjoy with you, eh? Yeah, thanks. It was awesome to have you here as well. Second time. So just saying goodbye to yours. That's the second time yours and I have seen the Inkahumas together take down the buffalo. Got off the ear. Ooh, there's a little bit of growling starting. Now Michael's wondering, are male cubs slightly more aggressive than females, especially around food? Well, generally they can be, just because they're a bit bigger. And in lion society, quite often size goes a very long way. Now wait, there's going to be, let's see how long it takes them before they get upset with each other and they can't share. As I said, they're so full, they're not really that worried about eating. The ears flat. No serious growling at each other just yet. females moving back in. Hi, Jerry. Jerry's wondering how long it'll take for them to eat that entire carcass. Big bull like this, Jerry, and they're not too hungry, probably 2 to 3 days. Now, it all depends if a male arrives, then of course the carcass won't last nearly as long. Excuse me. I was expecting a lot more growling, snarling between the little guys. And they're obviously so fat on mom's milk. And all the buffalo that they've been caught over the last little while. And it's more fun and games than feeding. Who's the king of the buffalo? Yeah, more playing than actually eating going on here. It's practicing the throat grip on the buffalo's armpit. A bit of growling, just but not much. We can hear frogs and a fiery-necked nightjar in the background. And of course we have an incredibly ecstatic Nkuhuma pride. If you've just happened to stumble upon us, this is live infrared viewing of lion pride on a kill. And can you believe we watched them take down this buffalo live? You are watching with me at the exact same time. Isn't that incredible? We are able to bring you the immense and amazing animals from Africa live wherever you are, might be in the world. Remember, hashtag SafariLive or questions at wildearth.tv if you'd like to send us any questions. Now, Doug in Connecticut's wondering, will the cubs be able to break through that tough buffalo hide with their still young milk teeth? Probably not. Maybe in some of the softer spots on the belly, but generally they will go, like those ones there, to where the lionesses have already opened up the carcass. Head in there. I can just sneak a head in there. I said they're not particularly hungry, otherwise there'd be a lot more snarling, growling and swatting. That little one, he's practicing catching buffalo up front. Not interested in eating. Oh no, he's caught and killed. He's happy. Yes, you big brave thing, you. So we're going to sit here with the Nkuhumas, but let's go see what's happening in the Mara Triangle with James.
Hello, everybody. Sorry about the very quick link last time, but I'm not actually sorry at all. You got to go and watch the little Nkuhuma cubs arriving at their kill, and well deserved it is for them indeed. Our cats, as you can see from the thermal imaging camera, are, well, very tired. But just behind them, a herd of what Graham Wallington calls bogies. The bogies have the wind from blowing sort of from the lions to them, we think. We can't really tell. It seems to be swirling slightly. But that is the potential hunt that might happen here if these lions can bring themselves to just wake up and do something other than nothing. There we are. Two sleeping on the left. One under a termite mound on the right. The other one lurking about here somewhere. Now, we think this is four lionesses. We're going to vaguely conclude that they might be from something called the Out of Africa Pride. It's been very difficult to figure out what's going on, because every time we thought we'd figured out what was happening, two more lionesses would appear. I'm assuming that we're not very far from where that zebra died, so I'm assuming two of these are perhaps the two that were at the zebra earlier. Then two more appeared as we got stuck. And then, of course, I didn't want to get my boots dirty, so we sent Graham and Tyler and Jandre and William out to push the car out, and they did that very successfully. We then followed these lions, and they went to sleep, which is what they have done quite frequently here. I'm beginning to think that, A, they do quite a lot of killing during the daytime, and B, well, I mean, they hardly look like they're desperately hungry. So they do quite a lot of feeding during this time of the year and quite a lot of hunting during the day. But the Kichwa Tembo Pride, who knows what they're doing tonight? Who knows what the males are doing? We took a gamble on this bunch and, well, hasn't quite paid off like the Nkuhumas have. But, you know, if you've got vehicles traversing the entire continent of Africa as we have at the
roughly the speed of light, about half the speed of light, let's be realistic here. It was very fast. Okay, this is the only road on Djuma that I have yet to drive at night. This is the first time I've driven the shortcut off Galago. It's a stupid name, I know, but it is what it is. And now, my plan is to go to Zoe's Road, which is where we were with Tingana when I said that there's a whole host of aardvark burrows in that particular area. And that's where we're going to head to. I'm determined. I cannot believe that of all the 5 days that we've been trundling about in the darkest of nights, we haven't yet encountered an aardvark. Hello, Zebby. Hey. As you know, we don't spotlight diurnal animals, and this zebra's not particularly comfortable, so we can switch to... no, never mind. I'm sure you're all, as our zebra disappears off anyway, I'm sure you're all dying to know what's happening at that buffalo kill. Let's head across to Brent and his adorable little cubs.
Well, they're still feeding, and it's quite disconcerting to sit here in the pitch black, and I mean, I can see my monitor, but if I look away from my monitor, all I can hear is this crunching and growling. So I'm going to keep quiet for a bit and let you just listen. No, mine. go find another spot to eat. Hi, Natalie. Natalie is wondering, if hyena came, would the cubs be safe if the lionesses had to protect the kill? Natalie, they generally protect the cubs before the kill. So it all depends. And so there are not too many hyenas around. And I don't think our clan is around, firstly, or possibly big enough to challenge all of these lions at the moment. So there's four adult lionesses around here. So the average, and there's three hyenas to one adult lioness before they become brave. Ooh. Little disagreement there. So you'd need at least 10 hyenas to really trouble these lions at the moment. But still, relatively civil dinner so far. As I said, they're so well fed at the moment. Not too much fighting. Such sort of low constant. Mine. Trying to get a sneaky bite from above. So you can see that the behavior around the kill at night is pretty much the same as it would be during the day. Hi, Jean in North Carolina, and Jean would like to know, was this Zander's first lion kill? Zander, was this your first lion kill?
Yep.
Was it your first to kill?
Yep.
There we go, it was indeed Zander's first lion kill, and I'm very happy to have experienced it with Mr. Eggsy. We are both smiling from ear to ear, although you can't see it in the dark. Well, you can with infrared, but I can't. Yes, and see, they're so well fed, they're more playing than eating, quite a few of them, jumping up and down on the carcass. Chewing on the ear, which is not very tasty and not much meat there. But I suppose nice chew toy. Look at that spitting. Oh, we can hear some bushveld rain frogs calling now. That wah, wah, there, that noise there. One of my favorite frog species. They look like grumpy old men. Only two lionesses here. I think the other lionesses might have headed off to go have a drink of water at Buffalo's Hook. Oh, that is a severely flat cat. Hard work for the night's done. Hi, TJ. Now, TJ wonders, you're going to get a smack, little one. What is the order of feeding? Cubs first, then lionesses first, males. Doesn't want to eat, wants to play. Well, TJ, it all depends on how hungry everyone is. This is quite calm and sedate because no one's particularly hungry. Now, normally adults will tolerate cubs, but they will try to eat the most first because they need the most energy, specifically the mothers, because they're producing milk and they have to do the hunting. Now, if a male was here, a male would dominate the carcass. Sometimes males will tolerate cubs feeding with them, sometimes they won't. It all just depends on the individual and the mood he's in. So there's no set order. It all is depending on quite a lot of variance. But generally, lionesses will tolerate cubs feeding and feeding around them and irritating them to a degree. Oh, what's going on closer to us? I can hear sounds. There we go. That's what I could hear. A cub talking. And obviously came to see the sleeping lioness. I could not see it. I just heard that. Now that phrase, spitting with anger, it has to come from cats. Nothing else can quite spit with anger like a cat. That wah, wah. Now, for those of you who might have stumbled upon us, we are live in the African bush. These lions have just killed this adult buffalo bull, and they've brought the cubs in to feed. Not only are we live, but we're also interactive. So I'm gonna ask you guys, what should we do next? Should we stay with these little lions as they devour the big buffalo? Or should we test our luck? Oof. Bit more serious of an argument there. And see if we can find any other incredible nocturnal creatures to view. And let me know by using the hashtag SafariLive. Or send an email to questions@wildearth.tv. And the temperature's dipping, I'm just putting my jacket on. Hi, Marion. Marion is in the Lone Star State, Texas. And Marion is wondering, why didn't they remove the stomach contents before starting to feed? Well, because they're not particularly fussy, Marion. So, I mean, earlier you would have seen they were actually eating the intestines with the stomach contents still in it. Just have a look to our right here, Zunder. The lioness is looking up. I think those other lionesses might be coming back from their drink. They're looking into this area here. Now, as I say, we're using infrared, so what I can see, absolutely nothing, unless I look at my little monitor in front of me. Do you see anything? I don't know. Oh, anyway. All we know is sometimes a lion might appear right next to us. Now, these lions have been so well fed during this drought. As you can see, they're not too perturbed about eating. And the cubs are more playing than feeding. Well, there's a couple of them getting really stuck in there. Ah, there, that's what they might have been looking at. There was something around in the bushes next to us. I think just judging from that behavior, and you can see she's not lactating, that's Auntie Amber. Oof. There we go, a bit more serious fight going on there now. Sarah's wondering, why do the lions lick the buffalo skin? Now, Sarah, if a lion had to lick you, if it had to lick sort of two or three times in the same spot, it would actually take your skin off. It's like very coarse sandpaper. So they actually lick to soften the skin up a little bit before they start using their teeth to open it. Now, a lion lick, if done constantly in the same place, would actually remove human skin, and they're very, very rough tongues. Oh, we can hear that little one right next to us again. It's walked probably, there they are. No, they are no more than about 5 feet from us. The only place that's really open for the cubs to get in is at the rump, and there is another spot up on the back. But look at that one, he's fast asleep on top of the buffalo. Tired kitty. You can see those other two towards the front are just playing. That little one to the right, imagining it's caught this buffalo all by itself. No, let's annoy the sleeping one. Fine, I'll go sleep somewhere else. Oh, that's a trouble causer atop now. Full of beans, or actually full of buffalo. Thank you. I see that one's managed to get in through its nether regions there. That area was opened up by the lionesses earlier. Laura is wondering, do I think they're letting the cubs eat first because nursing hurts, and not only because they've been eating well, so eating meat will lessen them nursing. Laura, I don't think so, especially not on a carcass of this size. I mean, there's enough meat to go around if they all wanted to eat. So I don't think so. I just think they're probably quite exhausted after the hunt, and that's not unusual, and they're just really well fed at the moment. It seems like when they go shopping for buffalo, they take them down at will at the moment with the drought. Well, one thing about sitting in the dark is you don't see when you're knocking things over. Now, Simpkin's wondering, how old are these cubs? They're various ages. I think the youngest now probably just over 3 months, and the oldest must be close on 5 months. And Simpkin's also wondering, when are they weaned? They're probably completely weaned by about 6 months, when they lose their milk teeth and start developing their adult teeth. Their adult teeth push through and the milk teeth are all gone by about 6 months. Not to say they won't take a chance and try suckle after that, particularly if there's different ages of cubs. So some females will lactate, or they're lactating at different times. The older cubs will often try to take a chance, because lions practice allo-suckling, so they don't only suckle their own offspring, but they'll suckle all members of the pride. Okay, we're going to sit here for a bit longer, see what happens. And I don't think too much more is going to happen at this buffalo carcass apart from cubs playing who's the king of the buffalo. So let's jump all the way back. Over 2,000 kilometers to Kenya and see what James is up to.
And we now seem to be following the lions. They've got up and they're moving. I can't see them. Jandre, can you see them? Okay. Okay, more lions at 12 o'clock. They're on the move. Hoorah, hoorah. Maybe they were just being polite. They're running now. Jandre, just give me a number.
It's 9:30.
Straight ahead. She's jogging. To turn these off. We'll just turn those on. It's too bright, isn't it? Jandre, if you see anything in front of us, you let me know, will you? Otherwise, we're going to go into a hole. Oh, you think they're going to the carcass? Well, let's see. They might be heading towards that zebra carcass, everybody. In which case, well, it's not quite a gill. Let's follow and find out. What a night we've had. Just by the way, we were sitting here, of course, in the car with these flat kitties, and we watched quite a lot of what you were watching. And how amazing was it that the nincompoops and now their cubs. Oh gosh, we're back with the dead zebra here. It promised so much. Done? Which lioness this is and why she started running here. So we went off, everyone, to try and see if we could find whether there's buffalo or wildebeest. It turned out to be wildebeest. Then we turned round, and that's what we found. So if you have just joined us, this zebra died, we think, as a result of injuries inflicted by a crocodile during one of the crossings over the Mara River. We watched two lionesses eating it earlier. One of them then threw up violently, and then we drove off and we found two others, and they were shortly joined, we thought, by the two that were eating this zebra. Now suddenly, they're back here. We don't know why she threw up. We don't know why nothing is eating this thing. We don't know why that whole group of four lionesses isn't eating the zebra. It's all rather strange.
The wildebeest aren't too far off.
And apparently the wildebeest, as Graham is saying, are not too far off. We're at 4 o'clock, so you're looking at sort of 10 o'clock. They're about 180 degrees behind us. And we'll just keep the thermal imager looking the other way at the wildebeest, because if she's got up and she's from the same group of lions, which, I mean, I can't see why she wouldn't be, she's come from that direction, it's possible the others will get up and spot those wildebeest as opposed to lie in the grass and do absolutely nothing. Now, this kind of situation, of course, where an animal dies of an injury inflicted either on it by crocodiles or perhaps by lions on a failed lion hunt. We know we've seen the Nkuhumas, who've become rather expert buffalo hunters. We know we've seen them fail before on a buffalo and leave it sort of walking around injured. I think that happens here quite a lot. There's obviously so many animals here that they probably hurt each other when they do these great crossings across the river. And so a carcass like this, lying in the middle of a clearing, sort of unattended, is not actually that unusual. What is unusual is that it has remained, or that these lions found it and then left it again. And thus, one of them seems to have come up. Graham, no bogeys. I'm afraid my thermal imager is down.
I'm going to guess that one more lioness is slowly walking.
So Graham reckons one lioness slowly making its way towards us.
You know me, I'm not one to guess.
No, quite. Now Graham says he's not one to guess, but that's not really true. Luckily, he guesses right most of the time. Now, I wonder if she hasn't smelt those wildebeest. That's where she looked off. The wind is in her favour, even though she's probably smelling the worst part of that zebra right now. So we shared a couple of theories, everyone, as to why the zebra, or why the zebra was left uneaten. One of them was, of course, that it has become infected by the crocodile's foul, rotten meat, sort of in bespattered teeth. There's something else off to the left-hand side there, and maybe that made it sick. So have you not got IR?
Thermal,
sorry. Why are there no hyenas here? That's also very odd. There you can see something just off to the right hand, to the left hand side, top left. The lioness has seen it. This could be quite interesting. Very interesting. And you can see the zebra, I would say, Graham, starting to cool there, wouldn't you?
Yeah, its fever must be dying.
Its fever's dying down, yes. I mean, interesting that it was, I mean, it was as white hot on that picture as the lion was when we first found it. Now it seems to be cooling down as a result of being dead. Sally, you're in Oregon and wondering whether the zebra was still glowing. Well, certainly not with the flush of life and the views of the Mara, but it is glowing slightly with the residual temperature of its recently ended life. But there, that bogey. Oh, we've got a pixel. One pixel off to the left-hand side of the FLIR camera, and it's now static. Anyway, we've got some lion action, finally. It's good news. Not quite the lion action we'd hoped for, but that's what happens here. Live wildlife television. And brilliant that we've had a live lion kill during the special week when we'd hoped to have just that. We've had two live lion kills this week. One from the Mara, one from... well, nighttime lion kills, one from the Sabi sand. And all in all, I think it's been a rather good return. Well, Zoe, interesting one from you. You say, do I think that it's possible for the animals to tell how putrid or sort of diseased this carcass is simply from smelling it, or do I think they need to probably taste it? I would have said they probably need to taste it. You know, they've got very sensitive noses, but they don't have anything like the number of taste buds we do, and they don't taste anything like the sort of complexity that we do, apparently. So I don't think the taste really bugs them. They probably get a sense of toxicity, though. I mean, in the same way that many animals get a sense of toxicity, at least many herbivores get a sense of toxicity from the vegetation that they eat, and they'll avoid poisonous plants. I'd love to ask this lioness why she couldn't have been bothered to go and catch a little wildebeest. Mmm, that would have been delicious. Now, Brooklyn, age 10, just in case, obviously you weren't with us a little bit earlier. Brooklyn, that thing is called a cecum. Now, a cecum is where all of the zebra's digesting happens. So it goes through most of the intestines, which are the tubes that come out of the stomach, and they go into that thing called a cecum. And in that cecum, Brooklyn, there are a whole lot of bacteria. Now, bacteria, I will ask you, is a kind of little... I suppose you could call it somewhere between an animal and a plant. It's very small. You won't be able to see it. It's the same kind of thing that, you know, if you get a cut on your body and it starts to turn red all around there, it's the same kind of thing that gets into there. But there are good bacteria and there are bad bacteria. And the zebra's got much, much good bacteria inside the stomach there. And that bacteria helps the zebra to digest grass. And one of the reasons you can't eat grass, Brooklyn, and why you have to eat things other than grass, is that you don't have the same bacteria as the zebra has in its cecum. And so that's why it's all, that's what that big thing is there. And it's so full because you see it's filled with gas. And those bacteria make a lot of gas. And I know that you have probably seen zebra running on Safari Live if you've been watching for a long time. Certainly we often see the zebra running close up in the Sabi sand. And sometimes, well, we've seen them running a lot here. And you know what they do when they run, Brooklyn. They often do what my dad calls let fly, which means they fart. And that's because of all the gas there in the cecum. So that's what that is. And you've actually got a cecum, Brooklyn. It's just very, very small. And it's called your appendix. Your appendix is just at the end of your large intestine. Now, this lioness has seen, smelt, or heard something. Probably that small pixel that Graham spotted on the thermal imaging camera. It doesn't seem to be coming any closer. What direction is she looking, Graham? Sort of towards 7 o'clock. We can't see anything coming on the thermal camera. That little pixel seems... She's also listening, everyone. You could hear something being killed, Graham says. Where, Graham? Keep her on the floor there, Graham. We just can't move everyone, she's very close. Can you still see her, Graham? You want me to drive, I'm going to drive forward slightly. Something is being killed, possibly a buffalo. Let's move. And turn the lights on. That is really vile. Where do you think, Graham? What direction? Well, she's heard it, everyone. Don't sit down. Come on, go and find whatever it was. Okay, let's be quiet here for a second, everyone. We're going to give a hard listen. I can't hear anything, but we've got lots of ears on the car. So everyone's trying to listen. But again, you can see... The lioness has left that zebra. Why? It's fresh food, you'd think. Can't hear anything at the moment, but she's definitely heard something. She's also... Is she facing the wildebeest? No, she isn't quite. She's walking back towards the, where the other lionesses were. This is very interesting. Well, the only way to solve this mystery is going to be to follow her. So that, everyone, is what we shall do. Twelve o'clock? Okay, I'm going to put a bit of light on, otherwise we're going to hit something. There we are. Still at 12? I can't hear. 2:30. Oh, she's right here. She's right next to us. Let's turn off here briefly. There she goes. She's now hunting the wildebeest, we think, everyone. We think we have a hunt on. Mr. Wallington is convinced of it. This is excellent. Let's see what happens. I'm going to follow her just within the infrared range. And there we got onto the thermal camera. You can see where she's going. Those are the wildebeest in the distance. It's going to be a little bit bumpy. Seasick safaris, briefly. But there she is. She definitely seems to be moving around them, possibly using the wind. Gosh, this is fantastic. Grief, can you imagine Safari Live got 2 lion kills in one night? Have you seen her? We've lost the flare somehow. Okay, I'm going to go a little bit quicker. Right arm down. So, just to explain, the numbers that have been called out, I cannot see. I cannot see what's going on, everyone. I am driving blind, in the same way that a helicopter pilot, I suppose, flies blind with instruments. My instruments are Jean-Dre on infrared and Graham on thermal image. 1 o'clock, slightly right hand down. Let's quickly go back to Jamie. I think she's got something interesting.
We've just seen a large spotted genet, which is something I've been dying to get on camera. I know you saw one with Taylor not so long ago. I'm really hoping we can get this one back on camera in a moment. Unfortunately, it ran away just as you were being sent across to us. Hold on a moment. Let's see if we can't find it once again. Come on, genet. Oh dear. Oh dear, oh dear. I don't think we're gonna get it. I'm gonna try. Come on, little genet. They're one of my favorite animals. They look like a cross between a mongoose and a cat. That's the way I always think of them. Like a small, long cat. They are not, in fact, a cat. They belong to a totally separate family called the Viverrids. They're from the Viverridae family. Little predators casting about looking for insects and small rodents and looking for them away from our vehicle. Darn. Okay. Now, since our genet has disappeared, let's go back across to James and his exciting evening in the Mara.
Look, everybody, look at this. The lioness, those little dots in the end there are the eyes of the wildebeest. She's walking straight towards them. I'm going to have to cut all light now completely with us. Jean-Dre, we need to be in eye arm. I'm sorry, man. I'm going to move slightly forward. Try and zoom in a bit. Sorry, man. She's going to chase now. I'm going to move a bit closer. Still at 12. There she is. We've got her there. I've got her. She's walking straight towards them. They have no idea she's there. I can see absolutely nothing in front of me. It's completely, completely black in front of me. Right hand down. This is unbelievable. Right hand down more. Okay, I'll try. What I don't want to do is spook the wildebeest. We're behind her by about... Oh, gosh. Sorry, we drove onto a hump. Oh, damn it. You still with her, Graham? Right on down. Okay, I'm going to have to turn some light on. I can't see. Okay. Okay, light down. So everybody, we okay, she's running. Okay, you must tell me, guys.
Right hand down.
Okay, don't shout. So exciting, everyone, this is so exciting. My heart is pounding. She's running. Where must I go? She looks like she's flanking left. Hold on, everyone. Give me a number.
Right.
Give me a number. Okay, we're going straight, everyone. Are you okay, Graham? So I nearly lost Graham off the back there. That would have been a small disaster. Well, a very large disaster, actually. Can't tell what's happening at the moment. I don't know if she's... You're going to keep going straight. She is on the left of the wildebeest. Okay, we're going to keep going straight. How's this? Going to keep going straight. I know you can't see anything, everyone, but we really don't want to spook the wildebeest or her. Now, she's closing the gap now. She seems to flank them from the left. I'm just watching a little bit of the thermal camera. She seemed so close to them when we saw them. And I don't know if they were spooked or if they ran a bit. But maybe we just fell behind when we hit that termite mound. Can't tell if she's running or not. Now she's running. She's running at them. I think she's running at them, everyone. I can just see the movement. I can see eyes in front of us. Lioness moving straight towards them. I'm going to have to kill the lights again. So now I'm driving completely blind. Can you see her, Jean-Ray? Okay, I got her now. She's running now. Oh my goodness, look at that. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. She's running. She's running. She's going. She's going.
Right hand down, right hand down.
She's running still. We can see her there, Graham. She's straight in front of us. There she is. She's missed. How did she miss? She was right on them.
They're scattered to the wind.
No. There's another lioness there. Everyone, my heart is absolutely pounding, mainly because I nearly lost the CEO of the back of the car. There, she's running again. There's another one running from the side there, Graham. Stay right, stay right. Yeah, there we go. Oh no, we've lost the battery.
Oh, unfortunately, the Mara lion seemed to need to take a lesson from the incumbents. As you can see, not much has changed here. All four lionesses are back. The other two are back from having a drink. And two of the adults are feeding. One's lying right next to us. There she is. And the other beyond. So I wonder where the youngest Inkhorn is. Is she off entertaining a Birmingham boy? And will they be here tomorrow? Now, as I said, such little infighting due to the fact that they're so well fed. And that little bit of rain came too little, too late for a lot of the buffalo, or this buffalo in particular. And we get a chance to pick up his condition yet. Been an absolutely incredible safari so far. Oh, mum going to get a little bit feisty? Cubs climbing on you, cubs putting their faces where you're feeding. Well, and back to King of the Buffalo. Or maybe it's just a good spot to have a snooze if you're a little one. And that's definitely one of the mothers there. You can see from her tummy. We know where to find the Nkahumas tomorrow. Now I wonder if there's going to be Birmingham boys with them. Because if there was one within 10 kilometers, he definitely would have heard the distress calls of that buffalo. Mad. Hi, Zaki, who's 21 in Kenya. So Zaki's closer to James than to me. And Zaki is wondering, how do mother lions know that their cubs are safe if they're too far away to hear the distress call? Well, Zaki, they don't. They have to rely on the fact that they've left the cubs in a relatively thick, safe area. And the cubs have to rely on their instincts. So when the mothers are not there, they don't make a lot of noise. They don't move too much. They try to hide as much as possible. Cubs pushing the adults away from the feeding area. Not too upset. She really wanted to, she'd swap them out of the way. Oh, give them a good lesson like that. That cub's about to get another disciplining. And look at the back, those two. Well, who needs meat when you got mom's milk? So even though there's a whole buffalo right there, they're suckling. Noises are just incredible. They know those lionesses are going to tolerate them, so they definitely do push their luck. As they get older, the lionesses will become less tolerant of the cubs feeding that close to them, and the cubs will have to learn to fight for their spot at the kill, which they already do even when they're suckling. Now, Monique in London says, I know we're giggling about the little growls now, but could they ever become sort of quite serious and aggressive? Now, Monique, there's always a chance that a lion cub will get swatted by one of the bigger ones and injured. I mean, one must remember, not too far back, there was a little Inkahuma cub, one of these guys, who could barely walk for a while. And that's almost certainly from being swatted either by a Birmingham boy or an adult lioness when they were misbehaving around a carcass. But at the moment, while it's a time of plenty, it's not such a problem. Oof! Oh, big growl, spitting man. It's the best way to describe it. Now, from a very successful hunt with the Inkahumas, let's go back to that lioness in the Mara who wasn't quite as successful.
Good heavens, everybody, we have just had an experience the likes of which you cannot believe. I'm afraid we lost battery power suddenly as she chased, and then she missed. She went off to the right-hand side after one of them, didn't seem to even go to full sprint, and then kind of, I guess she gave up as we lost battery. But it was tremendously, tremendously exciting. She got so close. I don't know how on earth she missed them. She could not have been more than 5 or 6 meters from them, maybe a bit more, maybe 20 meters from them. But she had a termite mound for cover. She was in complete and utter darkness. I must just reiterate that. I was driving utterly blind, couldn't see anything at all. And so the wildebeest had no idea she was coming, and she missed them. And the other two are just to the right-hand side of us. They're not within the infrared range. She's looking or smelling something else. But the others are quite far spread out from here now. So I don't know what they're doing. It's all rather bizarre. She's looking quite keenly at something. Graham, nothing else behind us, eh? To the left. Lady Macbeth, you're wondering if one lioness can take out a wildebeest. Yes, absolutely, easily, and especially as in a big herd of wildebeest, you've got wildebeest of all ages. You've got little calves. She's calling now. That's a contact call, though. That's interesting. Ooh, what's going on now? The mysteries of the Mara lions continue. She's going past the left, is she, Jondry?
Yeah. Well, she's dead 12.
So she's straight in front of us now.
She's coming back to the right. Very close.
Very close to the car. That's next to you, Tyler.
No, that's you, James.
Oh, is that me? Can't see where on earth this lion is. That's me there. Hello, everybody.
1 meter away from
you. She's 1 meter away from us now. Distance increasing. That's the thermal camera you can see. She's walking towards the other lions. Happy to move, Graham?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're all coming together now. I can put on a little bit of light because they're not in a complete hunt yet. Gee whiz, that was just incredible. So Lady Macbeth, yes, a lioness can absolutely take out a wildebeest, probably an adult cow. We watched a lioness take out, well, an almost adult cow yesterday. Sorry, I need a number, guys. Fair wind. Ah, there they are in front of us. Just see them now. The edge of the infrared. And one on the right of us as well. Oh, they're all moving now. 1 at 2 o'clock. Okay, I'm going to go towards 11:30. Let's leave the 1 at 2 for now. She'll presumably join the others. Yeah, they're up and they're moving together now. All right, while we follow these lions into the night, let's head across to Jamie. She's got another genet.
There we go, finally. We managed to get our little genet on camera. There it goes. Tuk, 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 tuk. Oh, wonderful. Where'd you go? Let's try and stay with it. As you can see, it is right next to Inga's house, which is where we live. How fantastic is that? The bright lights of James's vehicle reflecting beautifully in our spotlight. Let's see if we can't get it on the other side of this whoopsie termite mound. I might just go fall into bed. Just park the car and off we go. Where did you go? Okay, let's try this. Hopefully it hasn't crossed already. We should be able to get a really, really nice view of it. Hopefully it's nice and relaxed. Seems to be. Come on, little genet. Go slowly. I've seen this genet here before on my way home a couple of times, and it's always been relaxed. Where did you go? This is where it was. I'm sorry, let me just check that side as well. How did it do that? Pulled a disappearing act on us. Did it go up a tree? They can climb trees. Huh. Oh well, at least we managed to get that one on camera, Dave. Mm. Absolutely. Let me just check the other side quickly. Huh. It's vanished. Well, in that case, we're going to race to Galago Pan. We've just heard a report that there's a leopard calling there. I'm sure it's Tingana. That's the direction he was heading in. Okie dokie. Little Janet, sorry everybody. Don't know how it managed to disappear that quickly. It might have gone down a hole. All right, I'm going to race to Galago Pan. In the meantime, let's head back over to the Mara.
So the lions are now moving towards a woodland area where they seem to have heard something roaring or something calling. They had a full roar, which as far as our hunting goes is not a particularly positive sign, but goodness, these mysteries that we are unraveling here, hopefully even further to be sorted. What is just difficult to tell exactly what's on the thermal camera. They're walking right towards a woodland that is below the Ulololo escarpment. Alulolo, can't say that word. There were rumors of cubs in this area. Let's see. Now, quite unlike the woodlands of Djuma, we will not be able to drive down into this woodland because it is, well, it's basically it's a sort of forest. It's a patch of forest. We're keeping scanning with the thermal. She seems to have found something, yeah. Can you just move it on the side? moving again. Something coming out of the forest. No, nothing coming out of the forest. Right, there was one of them going basically into the forest in front of us. This one following. Not sure where the other two are. Graham, any idea? Other two in front of this lot. This might be the end of our lion tonight. Need to be very careful going in here. Hold on tight, everyone. Gosh, what a night it's been. Quite something if Jamie could top it off with another leopard. They're calling again. They're calling. I'm gonna keep going, everyone. I would normally turn off, but I don't want to lose them. Okay, I'm just gonna give you a quick listen. Something has spooked them, attracted them, caused them to come and think that there's some threat to their territory down here. It could be the males, I don't know. We've gone into some very thick stuff here. I'm going to turn the lights on, otherwise we're going to get ourselves into trouble. Yeah, they're having a bit of a play now. Where's that one, Hendry? Sorry.
12.
12 o'clock. Keep going. That, everybody, is a rather substantial canyon in front of us, over which we will not cross. What a night. Really does wonder what on earth they heard here. Marking territory, so something has alerted them. They heard something calling down here. They've come to mark their territory, that's why they were shouting, geeing each other up with their play behavior. Look at the heat coming off that bush that she marked. That's so cool. Let's have a quick look there, Hendry. See, just behind her, that's the bush she just marked. Look at the heat on that. No wonder that zebra stayed warm for so long. There, what's that at the far end of the screen? Sure. Wonder what that is. Could be a... Doesn't look like a hyena to me. Might be. Goodness, I wonder what that is. Top of the screen, everyone. Whatever it is running now, and they've stopped. And still, in the bottom of your screen, that bush that she marked, can still see it there, just moving in the top right. It seems to have disappeared now. I think, well, it looks like they're looking towards whatever that was. Well, the lion's at, where are they, at 11 o'clock?
11, yeah.
I'm just going to swing the car slightly, Graham, I won't go forward, fear not. You see them at all? There they go. They're going off to the left-hand side. Jean, hello, you're in North Carolina. You say, which pride is this that we're watching? Jean, this, we think, is what is termed the Out of Africa pride. Seems to be four lionesses, might include two cubs. It's all rather confusing. Now, we started off this, this kind of five-day lion hunt with the Kitrotembo pride. Four lionesses, we think maybe another one, not sure. And two young males, then the three males that we've been watching. Morani, a famous member of the Four Musketeers who was around this area with Scarface, and two usurping blonde males. They've also been around here, and then this lot here. A couple of nomads we've seen, and we've even seen the great Scarface himself. But this lot, we think, are what is known as the Out of Africa pride. That's rather fascinating. They've gone to sleep there on a ridge down through the dip. Yeah, and they're continuing to move down there. Something attracted them, everyone. They were on the hunt briefly, then they were sleeping, then suddenly they were up and calling and coming through here. Maybe they've got cubs here. Maybe they heard another lioness calling, or maybe a male lion calling the other side of this woodland. It seems to be a natural boundary between them and possibly the territory off to the south. We're facing pretty much due south now. But who knows? Well, that's a great honor to be learning all of this stuff from one of the most beautiful places I've ever experienced. I hope you've enjoyed it with us. I'm sure you have, especially as it has been trumped tonight, I suppose, by the Ngahumas and their cubs and their big buffalo meal. Hello, Rain. You say there's you're 16 years old, and you say the lions in the Mara seem to be different in their behavior, in that they just seem to frolic around a lot. They don't seem to be they kill their animals and then they don't eat them. Rain, I think it's very much not a function of the fact that they behave differently here. If you were to drop the Ngahumas here, I think they'd behave in very much the same way. I think it's just the fact that we're in the migration season. There's a lot in the way of prey around here at the moment. It's almost like a sort of three-month festival that they have. And everything's excited. There are wildebeest and zebra and Thompson's gazelles leaping across the river every day. They're coming into the clearings at night. Some of them are just dying of natural causes. It's like a real bonanza, smorgasbord of things for these lions to eat. And I think that's why they're behaving very differently. Toss in the pride male takeover, those two blonde usurpers coming in, kicking out Scarface, making friends with his brother Morani. Well, I just think it's got all the makings of a great, great story here in the Mara Triangle. And that's what's going on. I don't think biologically these lions are behaviorally different from the ones down south that have just fascinated us all by killing that buffalo and then bringing their precious little cubbies to have a meal with them. I believe one of them was sleeping on his food. Terrible habit, that. Yeah, nothing on the thermal there in the trees. You know, if a leopard had called here, there has been a leopard calling here tonight. I don't think these lions would have reacted. I think it's another lion that's come up from the other side and possibly called once. And these guys thought, no, that's not going to fly. Phew. Chandra, you've got no sight of them, hey? Outside of the infrared, at least the thermal. All this technology is so deeply confusing. In the background, we can hear some hyenas calling. All right, well, I think we're going to have to turn around. Graham, did you see all four go in here?
No, we've only seen three.
Yeah, we've only seen the three. Anyway, we'll go and see if we can't find the other one and maybe do a brief turnaround, see what else there is, and we'll catch up with you once you've said goodnight to Brent Lear Smith, who I'm sure was beside himself with excitement at the Nkuhuma kill today.
Wow, what an evening. The incredible Nkuhumas doing what they do best, catching buffalo. Now, that was absolutely fantastic. What a welcome back for me. First drive back, lion kill live. Now, I started today's drive with a little music quote. I think I'll end with it as well a little bit later. So, oh, where'd it go? Look at him go. Almost no tail. There's a little bushveld gerbil. See how short his tail is. Actually, don't think that's a bushveld gerbil. They've got longer tails. I actually don't know what little mouse species that is. Or maybe he's just lost some of his tail. He's not keeping still for us to look. No, I think he's lost. That is a bushveld gerbil. I just think he's lost half his tail. Maybe he had a lucky escape from an owl. That's not cool. I love those little things. We don't get them here in the Sabi Sands, but where I grew up in Botswana, probably the cutest little mouse you've ever seen in your life. And it's got the best name as well. Its name is a tiny fat mouse. And they're about this big and they're really little chubby guys. That was so cool. Now, I was actually hoping to find an owl in this area, but instead we saw what an owl has for dinner. Now, it is going to be fascinating to see tomorrow whether the fifth lioness arrives with a Birmingham boy in tow, or maybe just the Birmingham boy arrives. And, of course, unfortunately, we can't stay out after 10:30 in the Sabi Sands. That is the curfew. Now, the curfew is there to make sure there's not too many people driving out and doing naughty things after dark, of course. But what an incredible way to come back. Lions, I love those Nkuhumas. Eggsy's first kill. So Eggsy's also smiling from ear to ear. So, and I started the drive with that little quote from the late, great Lou Reed. Let's take a walk on the wild side, and we certainly did. And so good night, and we'll see you tomorrow for the sunset safari. Let's go see Jamie so she can also bid you adieu.
What an incredible afternoon and evening it has been, and I hope you've all enjoyed it at home. I've come racing down, believe it or not, to the back of the DRC, which is the camp that we live in. So I went to Galagopan, I heard the leopard sawing, and he's between us and the Galagopan, in the most impenetrable thicket imaginable. So I was just hoping that perhaps he might decide and come and pay us, might decide to come and pay us a visit at some point this evening. Unfortunately, he hasn't popped out. So I can hear him sawing still in the distance, just between us and a Galago shortcut. So on that note, it ends a fantastic sunset safari. So a big thank you to Dave for his fantastic camera work, as always, as well as to the entire Safari Live, Safari Live team for their incredible work and a lot of stuff that goes on behind the scenes. And most importantly, an enormous thank you to all of you for joining us and sticking with us and enjoying our experimentation. Thank you and have a wonderful day wherever you happen to be. I'll see you tomorrow for the sunset safari. Bye-bye, everybody.
Three, two, one. Right, everybody, what a day it's been. We're just going to go down the road here, down Graham's favourite slippy, slidey road, onto the main road and just check, because we've found one more bogey to have a look at. And given that this is our very last night here in the Mara for this particular sojourn in East Africa, let's just go and have a quick look at what it is. Not too quick, because if we go too quick on this road, this Land Rover will lie on its side like one of those lions. What a wonderful, wonderful experience it's been here. I'll just tell you my impressions as we go down the road here. We'll be about 5 minutes, I think, and then we'll say goodnight to you. Wow, to be in a place like this with the endless landscapes, colors that you just can't believe and pop out, that no photograph will ever do any justice to, vistas that likewise no photographs will do any justice to. 3 o'clock bogey, sorry everybody, I'll try and be poetic a little bit later once we've stopped talking about bogeys. Do you want to go off the road here quick? Let's go have a look, see what the bogey is. Try not to get stuck again. It'll be a great injustice for me to get stuck at this late juncture. There's quite a lot of water down here. Anyway, as we move towards whatever this thing is, just the diversity of life and the sheer abundance of it has been overwhelming. And I've got to tell you, once or twice I've been left fairly watery-eyed by the things we've seen here. There's been terror, tragedy, triumph, little Thompson's gazelles being smashed by crocodiles, and other tiny little ones making it across the river. The endless cycle of the migration, the wildebeest and the zebra going to and fro across the river. Well, that looks like an eland to me. What is that? I think it's a bokke. It looks like an antelope, everyone. We'll just keep going. For now, get one last look at it. Any ideas, anyone? 2 o'clock. It is a reedbuck. We're going to leave the reedbuck alone. And you're all asking me what my favorite moment was. You're also saying thank you for the experience. I think my favorite moments, everyone, have been sharing it with you, learning with you about this amazing place and seeing things that I'd only ever seen on TV before and didn't really believe that they existed in reality, to be honest. And that I think the crossings probably my highlights, but as I said to somebody yesterday, they asked me what were the most amazing things that I saw, and for me I think it's been the sheer space, endless vistas, different every direction you look, a plethora of life in every direction, and that whole general kind of thing has been the highlight. Of course, the Thompson's gazelle crossing yesterday was probably my highlight, with the tragedy of it and the triumph of the little one that got out, made it out, found the rest of the herd and went off happily. Unfortunately, it's going to have to cross that river again at some stage during its life. Let's pack it in, everyone. I think we're into what might be described as the law of diminishing returns. We'll just quickly look down onto the road there. Can you see anything in front of us, Graham? No bogeys.
I think there's a
very small bogey. It's probably a sleeping, rattling cisticula. And we'll probably leave that one alone for the evening. All right, everyone. That's going to be it from us. Thank you so, so much for joining us. I've just unplugged my phone. I can't hear anything going on in the final control. Rebecca, you're going to have to give me more than 30 seconds to get through all I have to say. Because, I don't talk very much. Right, I'm going to firstly say a big thank you to Jean-André for his astounding professionalism. You have no idea the work that this fellow does over here. He really does work very hard. A huge thank you to William the Askari in the back and his, biblically named colleagues who helped us out during the last 4 nights. A massive, massive thank you to Angar Mamara for putting up with us. We've got Tyler with us today. He's down in the cockpit here. He's been extremely patient. He's about the same size as Jean-André and Graham, so he's been stuffed into this tiny little cockpit, which was built for somebody my size, and a big thanks to him and his incredible team. If you ever come to this part of the world, that is where you have to stay, because you will be overwhelmed by it. Mostly, a huge thank you to all of you, of course. A huge... Shut up, Rebecca. Let me speak. This is an emotional time. I'm going to pull you out if you're not careful. And big thanks to the Final Control for their efforts, of course, and to the other guides at the Djuma. They will also have experiences like this one day. But mostly to all of you for coming along the ride, because without you, of course, coming to these absolutely spectacular places would be utterly impossible. So thank you for coming with us, and we hope to bring you back here sometime soon. Until then, Rebecca, you may now cue the credits. I think she has cued them. Cue them now. Okay, we now have 30 seconds for me to waffle slightly further. So I will say to you again a big thank you for coming with us, and I hope that you will come back with us at some other stage. Who knows when that will be, but it's been a great pleasure, and we'll see you later. Bye-bye.